So good morning and welcome to lecture number 6 of the quantum theory course. Today we'll consider the integration of measurable functions, and we'll do this for a number of purposes. The key definition we're going to provide today is that of a Lebesgue integral. Now, last time we had the Lebesgue measure, and the Lebesgue measure was a very special measure on RD. Now, the Lebesgue integral is not necessarily be performed with the Lebesgue measure. So although it's also called the Lebesgue integral, it's just that, of course, Lebesgue worked on this kind of stuff. So the Lebesgue integral is more general. Of course, you can have the Lebesgue measure of a measurable function, an integrable function, with respect to the Lebesgue measure. Okay, so that can be the case, but it's not necessarily the case. So I would like to point that out from the beginning. And the key application we're going to look at today for quantum mechanics is we'll give a proper definition and some of the properties and why it's so important to have the Lebesgue integral. We're going to define so-called LP spaces. And roughly speaking, those are the spaces of functions whose pth power, or rather pth power of the absolute value, is integrable. But there are certain additional gymnastics one has to entertain in order to make this into a proper Banach space, or in the case p equals 2, which is even more special than the other ones, in the case p equal 2, the L2 space is even a Hilbert space, whereas the others are only Banach spaces, and the L2 spaces are is the space of square integrable functions, or which is only approximately described by the space of square integrable functions that in quantum mechanics appear all over the place. Okay, so that's our task for today, but before we can get there, we have a number of definitions to make in order to get the concepts straight. So the first section is on so-called simple functions. Other people call them elementary functions. They are an important construction tool in order to define the Lebesgue integral. And so we need to look at them first. So as a technical tool, we introduce the following definition. A measurable function let's call it S, like simple, a measurable function on some set M into the real numbers, but we will in fact only look at functions into the real numbers that are non-negative, is called a simple function. Is called a simple function if S takes the entire domain into only a finite image. Several remarks. Well, first of all, if I call this a measurable function, what do I need to know here? What do I need to know? What structure on M and what structure on R plus 0 do I need?
We need measurable spaces.
We need measurable spaces, that's right. So I need a sigma algebra here, and I need a sigma algebra here. So implicit, when I say measurable here, implicit in that is that I have chosen a sigma algebra, sigma on here, and that I have chosen one here. Well, this one here, this is free to be chosen. That depends on the application, whatever set and whatever sigma algebra you have. But we have an agreement what we do on the real numbers. What kind of sigma algebra do we choose there? Well, we usually choose the Borel sigma algebra, and here, so you could take that of the standard topology, or if you wish, you can first restrict to here, so you have to induce topology on R plus zero, something of the type. Okay, so a measurable function is called a simple function if, but now the actual definition of simplicity apart from measurability is just that the domain, that the function takes only finitely many different values. That's it. So it's truly a simple function, right? It must look somehow, well, it's difficult to draw this M because we don't know what type of set it is. So I make a double line, well, it's more like symbolic. And here I have R plus zero starting here. So it must look somehow like this, okay? And then at some point this goes on forever. This goes on forever. Well, forever meaning as far as M extends. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4 different values. N equals 4. Very, very simple. Okay, so now an immediate implication of that definition, and that is actually why we need the measurability in here, is that the pre-image of a simple of a set of just one of the values si with respect to the simple function, well, what is that? Well, this here is one point in R plus zero, which is equipped with this sigma algebra. So clearly a set consisting of a single point is measurable in here. So this guy here is Borel measurable. Okay, but because S is measurable, we know that this whole thing is in the sigma algebra of here, right? So this is just something I would like to draw your attention to. So that's the implication one that we keep in mind. And implication two is that obviously, because it only takes finitely many values, I can write this as the finite sum over numbers z which appear in this image. So this is the image set, right? So I pick the guys from this image set, and I can represent the function as this value times the characteristic function where, well, on the pre-image of exactly the set for this point z with respect to the simple function s. And this guy here, this is the so-called characteristic function, which we are going to meet a number of times in these lectures. The characteristic function is the following. It's a function that comes with a set down here, not necessarily a measurable set, although in this case, because of remark one, it is a measurable set. But the characteristic function for just any subset of the domain, of the map, for the set in question here, this takes you from M to just two possible values, 0 or 1, but let's not be so stingy. Let's say the map goes here, and it takes a point M, it maps it to the characteristic function chi down A of M, and it does a very simple thing. It yields a 1, it gives you the heads up if the M happens to lie in the specified set, and it says no if M doesn't lie in the specified set. It's an indicator function or the characteristic function of the subset A in the set M. So this is an object that will appear very often. And again, here we know it's a characteristic function over a measurable subset, but that's because of this special construction, and that will be important in a second. Okay, so we can have this representation because obviously if you go over here to this little picture, you see that wherever you have the pre-image here, right, this is, if this is the value z, then this guy here is the pre-image of the map S of the point Z. That's this guy, and obviously wherever, if whenever you're with your M somewhere in here, you have to get the value Z. And that's precisely what this does. And the finiteness, please note this, because this is finite, this really is a sum, right? So it's not a series, it's a sum. There are no convergence issues, and we're fine. Okay, so these are the so-called simple functions, and they will play a role in a moment. Any questions so far? Okay, so then let's go already to integration, and we might think that we first start integrating simple functions. That's not quite correct. We will be much more general. We'll immediately define integration or Lebesgue integration, but from now on integration will always be Lebesgue integration. Integration for non-negative measurable functions. So I already indicated last time that the measurable functions will be the ones we're going to integrate. Well, almost. There will be a small extra condition. Not every measurable function is integrable, but almost. Okay, there's a small extra condition and then we're done. However, in this section 2 rather than in section 3, we still make another restriction, and that is that the integrals we're looking at the moment are first going to be defined for non-negative measurable functions. And in the next section, we'll extend to any measurable function that satisfies an extra criterion. Okay, so so what is a non-negative measurable function? Definition, by a non-negative measurable function, we mean an f that goes from some measure space, we'll see that in a second, well, first of all from some set M, into R. And do you remember last time I introduced this R bar? This R bar, and this R bar was simply R union with minus infinity and plus infinity. Again, I emphasize, why would one ever do that? Because whenever a function, say, diverges, why don't I just remove that point where it diverges from the domain? That's the standard procedure. Well, the point is I want to leave the domain untouched, so, and I take care of such functions by extending the values of their target to minus and plus infinity. Okay, so that's an alternative trick, and that serves us here better. Now, however, we want a non-negative measurable function, such that, well, that's now very simple, f of m is greater or equal to 0 for all m. Okay. For all m in m, that's the first condition. And the second condition is simply that it be measurable. Now, the second condition, again, what do we need? In order to even say measurable, we need to have chosen a sigma algebra here, not yet a measure, right? Measurable only needs that. But we also need a sigma algebra on here, right? Now, I cannot simply say that I take the Borel sigma algebra of R, because this is no longer the set R. I need to say how I deal with the sigma algebra here. And the point is, I'm going to equip this with a sigma algebra sigma bar, which contains exactly those sets A, I need a little more space here, those sets A, subsets of R bar, because that's the sigma algebra for R bar. Which ones do I take? Well, I take those that, if I intersect them with R, not with R bar, happened to lie in the Borel sigma algebra of the underlying R. Or in other words, I do not care whether the set contains a plus infinity, a minus infinity, or both, because it qualifies as being in the sigma algebra sigma bar already if its intersection with R alone is an element in the sigma algebra R. So I turn a blind eye to whether plus or minus infinity is in a certain subset if I am to judge its measurability, right? Very simple, but it needs to be said at this point. Okay, so we have to make the small extra definition in order to afford the luxury of not taking out points from the domain, but rather having them in the target. And this is, of course, here, this here, is the non-measurability, it's the non-negative, it's measurable, it's the non-negativity, okay? So we're going to look at such functions first, and for these we're going to define integrals, and there will be no extra condition at this point that's needed, so all measurable functions that are non-negative you will be able to integrate. Later on, if we drop the non-negativity condition, that is the point where a small extra condition beyond measurability enters. Okay? But at this level, measurability is integrability. Okay? Hence, it makes a lot of sense to call those functions measurable. So you said you saw the Lebesgue integral in your mathematics lectures, but not from a measure theoretic perspective. That's what I understood.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. So you will probably be able to make contact, but technically we're doing it slightly differently. Is that a fair summary? That's good. That's good. Okay. And if we didn't need this measure theoretic perspective for other reasons as well, I wouldn't bother you with it. I'd say, okay, you know the Lebesgue integral, that's fair enough, but this measure theoretic perspective will be needed anyway. So we can already practice here. Okay. So in order to define the integral, or an integral, the integral of a non-negative measurable function, we need to have a measure. And now where do you guess you need the measure? You want to, if you think of the Riemann integral, right, the idea is that you make equidistant steps like this. So where do you need the measure? Well, one could think one needs a measure on this axis, on the domain, and on the domain, on this axis, and on the target, so that I can measure this one and can measure this one somehow. Okay. Well, because this is the axis R, there's a Lebesgue measure, and then it's rather trivial. You just take the difference between these two. You could talk about this as being measured. Already in the Riemann integral, you actually need a measure down here. Now you need little absolute values or something like this. Now in the, so this is the Riemann philosophy of finding the area under a curve. Now the Lebesgue philosophy is different. The Lebesgue philosophy says, find simple functions, actually look at all the simple functions, like for instance this one, right? This is a simple function, from now on it goes like this, and well, let's say the whole thing ends here and ends here. Okay, now this is a simple function. It says, look at all the simple functions and actually find the supremum of all these, or rather supremum of the area underneath. So in a sense, rather than making the bars like this, here you make the bars like this, right? Okay. Anyway, so that's the Lebesgue philosophy. All of this is talk and not needed. It's just a common way to illustrate the difference. And so you may keep that in mind, but maybe you only understand it once I made the definition, and then you can compare to the pictures again. We need to have a measure mu on the domain. So it is absolutely irrelevant what the measure on the target is, although if you established here something else, but yeah, anyway. So let's say we need the measure on the domain, and the domain is what here is a rather abstract measurable space. So you need to provide somehow a measure. Okay, anyway, the definition is the following. Definition is the following. M sigma mu be a measure space. R bar with the sigma bar is a measurable space. We know that. So this is almost more like a comment, whereas this is let this be a measure space. Okay. Then the integral, and that has just a symbol, that's integral f d mu. There are no x's flying around, a little m's, f of x dx or something. It is this symbol, and this d mu is just a symbol. Okay, then the integral f d mu of a non-negative measurable function. Is the number, but be careful, it's the number in R bar, so it could be plus or minus infinity, integral f d mu is defined as, what do you need to do? You take the supremum of the following numbers. You take the supremum of the sums where z is in Sm. What is s? Well, you do this for all simple functions s with S lies everywhere below f. So this is pointwise. Okay? So I have a function f, and I find any, for instance this one, but I need to look at all of them, simple function s, f, that everywhere lies below f, because f is positive, that makes sense, okay, to look at it like this. And the simple function ought to be positive too. Did I say that? If I define simple function, I say it needs to go to r plus 0? Yes, I did. Yeah, that's very important. So the simple functions, because otherwise it could go negative here. It doesn't do that. Okay, so I could emphasize this again by writing this here, but I already wrote it in the target. So now you look at all the simple functions, and what you do, you want for a given simple function that lies here, you want to find this, right? You want to find this area, if you wish. But this area here will be the height z in one part of the function times the measure for the pre-image. Aha. So then you write here, this is z times the measure of the pre-image with respect to the map S, where it of the value, so it's the pre-image of this Z here, of the value it takes. Okay? And so this is height times width. But the width depends on how you measure this part, how you measure this set. Okay? Height times width and the pre-image here. And now you see it's important. Before it wasn't important, but this here is in the sigma algebra of the domain, right? That was important. You remember that was remark or implication one before, because if it wasn't, I couldn't feed it into the measure. Hence, that was important. And that's it. And so you look at all the simple functions, and you always take the area below them. But then if you do that for all the simple functions there are, it's the supremum of all of those, okay, that yields what we call the integral of f over m. And this is over the entire space m, right? This is over the entire space m. We usually don't write this down. If nothing is written there, it's over the entire space where the function is defined. Okay? Are there any questions so far?
We said it's only in the back integral and if they are both equal. Is this important here?
No, I don't think so. I mean, that's what you need to do in the Riemann integral. Ah, Lebesgue integrable. Aha. So that will be taken care of because these are only for the non-negative functions.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So we'll take care of this in another way. So now I understand. So one does more at once. Yeah. But we'll take care of that otherwise. You'll see. Because you see here, any non-negative measurable function is integrable. Well, the number could well be plus or minus infinity. No, not minus infinity, but it could be well infinity, right? But that's fine. It's still integrable. It just yields infinity. Okay, and we'll see a slightly stronger condition for general measurable functions. A condition at all. Okay. So, definition. Let A be an element of the sigma algebra, so that is a measurable subset of M. Then we define the integral over a non-negative function d mu over the subset simply as integral f times characteristic function on there times d mu. And so you see this dot, where does this dot live? On which set does this dot live? What dot is this? No. If I had written f of m times psi a of m, then this would be the dot in the real numbers because f goes to the real numbers. But instead, I write f times psi a of the real numbers are defined. So this is defined like this. But then this is a multiplication on the set of functions. Whatever set you can restrict or not, but on the set of all functions from M to R. Okay? So multiplication on there. Okay, but that's not important. I just want to point your attention to the fact that here there is no f of x, d mu of x or something like this. These are the functions proper, not the function values. Okay? So please get used to this. I'll tell you a little later another notation that is closer to the notation you know, but it's best to first think about this a little. Let me give it now. So anyway, so this is if you restrict the domain, you do it like this. So now notation. So this is perfectly meaningful. Because why do you need to write of x or something? This is a function that's being integrated over a domain. Now, however, it is often very convenient, and I'll explain why it is convenient. It is often very convenient to write, and what we write is then integral f of x. Now, mu dx, so the dx goes into here, apart from the mu, this looks very much like you know it, right? Like what would denote an integral. Instead of, but this is really just notation. So you could say it's a definition of the left-hand side. Instead of integral f d mu. Well, this is the object we defined, and that's the number down here. That's this. So why would I put an x behind here? And why would I put, you might have thought I write d mu of x. No, I write mu of dx. Well, first of all, it's notation. You could just accept it, but it has a very good application. Very often, for instance, in the spectral theorem and elsewhere, we want to write something like this. We want to write here, for instance, sq sub r d mu. And there's a function that's called sq. It's one, or yeah, sq. It's one name for the function, sq. And this famous sq function is the function on r, is the one from r to r that takes an x to x squared. Well, it's the function that squares. Okay. So if you want to write the integral over x squared, you need to write integral, the name of the function, which is sq, right? And what the function does is this, right? But it would be so much more convenient to write instead sqr of x, mu dx. Why would that be more convenient? Well, because sqr of x, instead of writing this, you simply write x squared. Because sqr of x is x squared. Okay? And this is what we usually do. We say the integral over x squared dx. What is that? But x squared is not a function. It's the function values. Okay? So very often, it's just very convenient to write the function values rather than the function itself. Because until I made all these definitions, it's much cleverer to write this. And then you see the difference because we then write mu dx, and also makes some sense because dx intuitively is a little part on the axis, and that needs to be measured. Okay, so it makes a lot of sense. Anyway, that's the notation. So we write this instead of this on the right-hand side. And similarly, if I write integral x mu dx, it's the integral over the identity on r d mu. Okay? But that's just notation, but one could get easily confused if one doesn't explain this. One could get easily confused about what's going on. Okay. So let's, other questions so far? So still, we're dealing with non-negative measurable functions, which are all integrable. Well, we didn't define the notion of integrable yet, for which the integral can be written down and it exists, right? Possibly with the value plus infinity, but that, of course, doesn't scare us. Now let's list a number of properties which, if you attempt proofs of theorems in this context, are very useful. So properties, but I remind you, f non-negative measurable. So it's not all of these will translate to the general case of a measurable f. Anyway. So the first one is the Markov inequality. So what you need for that, you take a non-negative real number z, and you know then that integral f d mu is less or equal to, again, f is non-negative, less or equal to z times. Now I always need to draw this little picture to remember. So there is the function f, and you look at the measure, well, you look at the measure of the set where the f takes values that are bigger than some z, so let's say here, Okay, so that's where the F takes those values. But now you calculate the pre-image of this one point set Z with respect to F. So that would be in this case, this here, right? So this is the pre-image that I write down here. And then you can measure that, okay? You measure that and you multiply by Z. Okay, so you get this one. So what you get here on the right-hand side of this inequality is you get the blue domain, not domain, the blue set, and you calculate its contents, well, its integral by this number Z times the measure of this here, and it's not hard to see that the integral of f d mu will always be, well, it's the other way around, greater or equal to this. Okay? As the Markov inequality. Well, other stuff follows more directly, needs not much explanation. Let's say f is less or equal to g, then it clearly follows that f integral f d mu is less or equal to integral g d mu, but even better, also if this is only the case almost everywhere, so up to a set of measure zero on the domain, so g is also a non-negative measurable function, then still the integrals have this, roughly speaking, because the sets of measure zero are not seen by the integral. And similarly, we have f equal to g almost everywhere. That already implies that the integrals, in fact, agree. Do I have to put in almost everywhere here? Why not? They're real numbers. This is an equal sign on real numbers. This is an equal sign between functions. Here I can talk about where it's equal or not. Almost everywhere between real numbers, it makes zero sense to say almost everywhere, right? So always, so also equal. There's more than one equal sign in mathematics, right? Okay, that's this. So then we have fourth. What can you conclude if you know that the integral f d mu is zero? Well, you have been trained to not conclude much from that. But in fact, if f is non-negative, you may conclude, at least for the Lebesgue integral, that f is zero almost everywhere, right? Because it was non-negative. And then the fifth is if the integral of f d mu is less than infinity, if it's finite, then you may conclude that f is less than is finite almost everywhere. Okay? So these are just some standard conclusions. Now comes a very important theorem. And to an extent, it's the pivotal theorem, the theorem around which everything turns in Lebesgue theory. In a sense, it's what Lebesgue theory is made for. And it is stated here for non-negative functions, and later on for general measurable functions that are even integrable. I always talked about a little extra criterion having to be implemented there. It will immediately imply another important theorem, but let me state it here. So the pivotal theorem of Lebesgue theory, well, Lebesgue integration theory, is the following. It's the theorem, and it has a name, on monotone convergence. Monotone convergence. And that will appear in many proofs later on. And its companion, that's not only valid for the negative functions, will be called the theorem of dominated convergence, which will also appear again and again. So what do we have? Let f1 be less or equal to F2, less or equal to da 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 da, and 0 less or equal to those, be a sequence of measurable functions. So without measurable, nothing can be done here. Of measurable functions, all of course on the same domain, otherwise how would I compare them, and all into R bar, but in fact they're all positive. So they're all non-negative measurable functions. Okay? Now, provided that the f, that there is a function f, which is, and now comes something, is the sup of all the fn's for n greater or equal to 1. And the point is the sup needs to appear here because we have the extended real line. If we didn't take the extended real line, you could write lim, okay? And this is supposed to be pointwise. So for your intuition, think if the fn converge pointwise at every point, the value fn of m, little m, converges to the value of a function m, right? Then you can take the integrals over the individual members of the sequence, and then after you took all the individual integrals, you could let these numbers, the sequence of real numbers you have, or numbers in R bar, you let that go to infinity, and what you will obtain is simply the integral f d mu. So if you go here just to real numbers and you write here the lim, that's also true. The idea is you can exchange the integration with the lim. And again, this is unheard of in Riemann integration theory, that a pointwise convergence of a sequence of functions, where only you need to check for each individual value whether it converges, rather than, for instance, uniform convergence or something like this, would allow this. For Riemann integral, this is simply not true. And this is a simple condition, right? And you know uniform convergence, you don't only look at the individual points, but in a sense as the function as a whole, how it converges. I mean, this is much more convenient, right? And so this is by virtue of having defined the Lebesgue integral rather than the Riemann integral, okay? And apart from that, you see the functions, they start in some set M with a sigma algebra sigma and a measure mu. This could be a very strange set with a very strange sigma algebra and a very strange measure. The Riemann integral, you need to know you're over the real axis somehow so you can make your little dx equidistant steps or whatever, okay? So this is a much more general, much more powerful notion of integral, which we will be able to apply in quantum mechanics a lot, and it has nicer properties. So the Lebesgue integral is the way to go. Okay, not only in physics, also in mathematics. Okay. Questions so far? But still, we're still working with non-negative measurable functions. Not measurable functions per se, but only non-negative ones. But all the ideas are there, right? Treating general measurable functions with a little extra condition will be just very simple. I mean, that's not a big thing that's happening there. So all the ideas are already injected. Okay, so before we push on, let's collect two results. So theorem, well, you could call it the theorem on, you don't give it a name, it's simple enough. Let fg greater or equal to 0 be measurable. So here I also said non-negative. Let them be measurable. And let alpha be a non-negative real number, then it's quite easy to show that the integral over f plus alpha g, again, that's the plus on the function space. This is if you want an S multiplication on the function space considered as a vector space, whatnot. You know how that works. So it's just on the functions d mu. This is simply f d mu plus alpha times integral g d mu. So what you would expect that the integral acts linearly. Okay, so this is a standard result. And an immediate conclusion from monotone convergence that I just wrote down, and this theorem here is that for any is this for any measurable function? No, it's for any positive measurable function. Yeah, for any sequence. Fn of positive measurable functions. So all these must be measurable. We have, as a combination of the previous two theorems, that taking the Fn, n equals 1 to capital N, and then taking the integral, no, even if you take the series, integral over the series is the same as the series over the integrals. So you can also exchange infinite sums with the integral. Well, this one shows you can exchange finite sums by induction, but this shows you can exchange these guys. Again, unheard of for the Riemann integral, where this simply is not true. For the Lebesgue integral, you can do this. You can imagine how useful this will be on infinite dimensional Hilbert spaces. Okay? So this is this. And so how was the monotony coming in? Well, because these Fn's are all non-negative, so if you keep adding them up, the next summand, so it's not the F, but the partial sum, will always increase. So you get this theorem for free, but they need to be non-negative. Yes, I did. Thank you. And again, this is the sum sign, not on the real numbers, but the sum on the function space. Okay. Yes, so that's it. So we have all non-negative measurable functions under control. We can integrate all of them. Also here, possibly the result is infinity on both sides, but it will then be infinity on both sides. Okay. Any non-negative measurable function can be given a value in R bar with this definition of integral. Great. So all that remains is to get rid of this non-negativity condition.
I have a question.
Yes. 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 So that's what I said. Then both sides are infinity. It does. Okay. So that's now section three, I assume. That's section three? Yes. Integrable functions. So the general idea is, in order for a general, meaning here not necessarily non-negative, non-negative function as discussed so far. So in order for a general function, F defined on a measure space into R bar. To be integrable, meaning having integral f du mu defined, one needs, beyond measurability, beyond f being measurable, that of course we cannot drop, one very small, so it's not a big deal, one very small extra technical condition. If this is satisfied, if this extra condition is satisfied, F is called integrable. No. So it's important to emphasize, because there's measurable and integrable, and what is what? Well, integrable is just a little more than measurable, and you only need it for general functions, not for the non-negative ones. So now, of course, that's my introduction to this section. Now we make this more precise. It's just to try to prevent confusion. So, more precisely, definition: a function f from M to R bar. Is called integrable if two conditions are satisfied. One, if f is measurable. And you know, for the measurability, all you need to know that M sigma is a measure space. And R bar with sigma bar, as we defined it, is a measure space too. Okay, so that always is implied, if we even start talking about being measurable. And two, the integral of the absolute value of f, d mu, must be less than infinity, must be finite. It could well be infinity, it must be finite. Okay, so this is the small extra condition. And a remark is that this condition 2, and that's the whole point, is equivalent. 2 is equivalent to requiring that f plus d mu is less than infinity. And at the same time, f minus, not minus 1, f minus d mu is less than infinity, where f has been decomposed into f plus minus f minus, minus f minus, where f plus and f minus are defined as the maximum of f, well the pointwise maximum of f in the zero function, pointwise, that's this guy, and the f minus, not the minus f minus, the plus f minus, is defined as the minimum of minus the function f and the zero function, pointwise. Okay, so in other words, if you have a function f that goes like so, then the F plus. Is this bit, and the F minus is this bit. And obviously, if you add the two, no, it's wrong. Yes, thank you. Don't need to say anything, it's wrong. That's minus F minus. Yes, now it's right.
Minimum of minus f.
Shouldn't it be maximum?
Minimum of minus f or minimum of f?
No, but then it will be
minus. Or minus the minimum. It must be minus the minimum or the maximum of f, of minus f. That's right. Yeah. That's right. Yes, thank you.
Like this, you just get.
Yeah. That's right. That's right. Of course, I knew. I just wanted to test you, of course. No, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Don't I always tell you draw pictures instead of formulae? No, I don't. Anyway, so, okay, so, but the idea is pretty clear, right? So you decompose this uniquely like this, and then the actual idea is that these plus, so you may wonder, oh, this is kind of an absolute convergence criterion or something like this. No, it's actually this thing here. You want the plus and the minus part separately to be finite. Why? Well, I haven't told you yet what the integral is. I just tell you what integrable means, but how do I want to write down the integral of such a function, a general function? Well, I need to, of course, reduce it to the integrals over non-negative functions. And you see the two non-negative functions loitering around here. That's the f plus and the f minus. They're non-negative functions. Two non-negative functions, and obviously I will want to use them. And so we define make the definition the integral f d mu of and now not measurable, but an integrable function, because we have the extra criterion of an integrable function f, is defined as integral f d mu is the integral over f plus d mu minus the integral f minus d mu. Now, the reason why I need to exclude that either of the two is infinity is that imagine that one is infinity and that one is 2, and then I have infinity minus infinity. Infinity plus infinity is good because that's infinity. Yeah, 0 minus infinity is also good or finite. But imagine you have infinity minus infinity, then you don't know what that is supposed to be, right? So you need to exclude that from the beginning, so we restrict functions that we want to integrate but that are not non-negative but can take any value, we restrict them by this extra condition in order to call them integrable. That's the whole thing. So it's only a minor but important extra condition between measurable functions from some measure space M sigma mu to the Borel to the Borel space, R sigma Borel, that makes a measurable function into an integrable one. Okay. Good. Now, in quantum mechanics, we are dealing not with real valued functions, but we need to deal with complex valued functions. In quantum mechanics, we need to deal with functions f that are defined on some measure space as here, but that lie in the complex numbers. Their integration theory f- follows immediately. So really, you don't need to redo anything even. That's the basis here. Follows immediately by treating the real part of F and the imaginary part of F, so that's then again pointwise, separately. So in particular, we would define the integral, well, let me call this a function capital F to the, well, it doesn't matter, F. The integral F d mu, but if F is complex valued, would then be defined as the integral real part of F d mu, which is a real function, which then is defined like this, plus I times integral the imaginary part of F d mu. And it is indeed a definition, because so far we only dealt with real functions. And you can very quickly check that, for instance, this condition really stays the same condition, but this is then the absolute value on the complex numbers, right? But that also follows immediately, right? So a complex function is, but you go backwards. You don't redo the whole thing. You go from here backwards. And then you also arrive here, and you have this for the real and the imaginary part separately, okay? But that finally yields the same condition for the complex absolute value here, okay? Very simple. That's what you do in quantum mechanics or in anyway for complex valued functions.
So F plus and F minus are then split into one real F plus?
No, the other one, the other way around. You split the F into the real and the imaginary part, and the real part will have an F plus and an F minus. So real F plus and real F plus, real F minus, and imaginary plus, imaginary minus, because imf is a real valued function.
Yeah.
That's it. So that's why I meant you roll backwards. Not you don't redo, you go backwards. So it's a fully logical exposition. It's not like we could have done that instead. It follows immediately with this extra definition. Okay? So we can integrate on general measure spaces. Very useful. Aha. So, important properties that are still there for general functions. Now we just take fg integrable, nothing more, okay, fg integrable. Then we still have that if f is almost everywhere less than g, we will still have that this is true for the integrals. Integral f d mu is less or equal to integral g d mu. Okay, and the second thing we have, well, that's of course the most important one, is for all alpha, but now before we had to restrict to positive real numbers because the non-negative functions constitute a cone, but the functions here, integrable functions, constitute a vector space. For all alpha in R, in all of R, it is true that the integral f plus alpha g for just any integrable function d mu is integral f d mu plus for any alpha, not only for positive alpha, alpha integral g d mu. Okay, so that's the, of course, the famous linearity of the integral. So before we have a short break, I come to quote the next very important theorem, and actually the only second, well, it's the second theorem we will always use, is the theorem on dominant convergence. Theorem on dominant convergence. So what are the ingredients? The ingredients are that I have F1, F2 dot 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 a sequence of, now you might think, integrable functions, but in fact we can be weaker, it's a sequence of measurable functions. So it's nice, you don't have to check the extra criterion, right? So that's nice, so let that be a sequence of measurable functions. Well, let's list the assumptions. A, let B, this sequence converge to a function f almost everywhere pointwise. So for almost every m in the domain, fn of m goes to f of m for some function f. Okay? We don't even assume that f is measurable. We just say it goes against this function. So now comes a second player into the game, namely these are the ones that submit, but now comes the dominant player. The dominant player is a non-negative measurable function. Let G be non-negative measurable. Aha! So we have a non-negative measurable function. We know that non-negative measurable, well, we know that we can always write down the integral, although it might be infinity. So we need to exclude this with integral g d mu is less than infinity. Okay? So I could have said, let g be non-negative and integrable. Because non-negative measurable that's finite is non-negative integrable. Okay? Anyway, you say this like you want. Such that, and that's the important thing, for all n in the family, the absolute value of m is less or equal to g almost everywhere. Yes, almost everywhere. Okay? So, I mean, the picture, of course, is that you have a g that lies like so, right? Then you mirror this, and any f in between must not go out of this domain given, not domain, out of this region bounded by plus or minus g. Okay? So that's the dominance. G dominates every single member of the sequence. Okay? So then we have the following conclusions from that, from these weak assumptions. Well, they're not so weak, but from the assumptions as they're here, like the fn's are only measurable and so on, we can conclude the following. It is simply very often the case that you can bound some sequence. Later on, when we deal with bounded operators, you construct from an unbounded operator, you construct, say, with some by some technique, bounded operators, even a sequence of bounded operators, and then you can see that things are bounded, and then you can already conclude. It's really great, right? I mean, it's really a very powerful theorem. Well, the statement comes now. Then we have several results. First, we have that f and each fn, well, f and f1, f2, f3, all of these, they're all integrable. Aha! So we only assume measurability, but the dominant being dominated by an integrable positive function, non-negative function, makes them all integrable, including the limit function. Very good. Very good. So we know that this goes to an integrable function. Every single one is integrable. Second, we know that if we were to calculate the integral of the individual fn's minus f, we could look at these differences, and we then integrate over them. So it's in a sense like the mean of this difference. And we take the limit n to infinity, this will be finite. So this could be called convergence in the mean. And the third result is that indeed you can again exchange the limits. It means that the limit of n to infinity over the integral fn d mu is indeed the integral f d mu. So everything is as nice as can be. Okay, that's it. So that's a very important theorem, and this situation in various guises will meet several times. So after the break, I feel very safe that you follow the lectures very carefully and point out several blunders that I made. First of all, here with the properties fg integrable, I need to require that the functions go only to r, not to r bar, because otherwise this property number 2 could result in the individual integrals diverging on the right-hand side, whereas the sum does not. For instance, if the alpha is minus 1, you could have twice a diverging integral f. So if f equals g and alpha is minus 1, but each integral f d mu could be infinity, and then you have here 0 d mu, and here you have infinity minus infinity, and you don't know what it is, right? But that can only happen if you go that to r bar, so you have to restrict like this. The second mistake over...
This restriction, wouldn't it be enough to say f and g are from m to r almost everywhere?
Well, you could probably make additional assumptions, but then it becomes even more. So this is the restriction one usually makes at this point. I forgot to make this because I was too sloppy. I didn't write down this the target. Okay. Then here I wrote less than infinity was absolutely right and absolutely useless. Well, almost. It's zero even. Well, that's the important point. It's zero. You know this joke with the somebody in a balloon in a you know that one, the mathematician's joke? No. So somebody flies in a balloon, right, and he flies around and he lost his way, and so at some point he comes to a place on over a field, and he sees like a little ant down there. There's somebody walking there, and so he shouts down there and he says, "Where am I?" And so for a long while there was no answer coming, right? And so then after a long while, the person from the ground called back, "You're in a balloon." And so how do you know it was a mathematician? Well, first of all, it took a very long time until he came up with the answer. Second, the answer was 100% precise. And third, 100% useless. Okay. So anyway... So that was of this type, right? It took anyway. So and then with the Markov property, and that was the third blunder. And I beg you, don't point out a fourth one, or I go home immediately. obviously, here in the Markov inequality, from the picture alone, it's clear that you need the preimage of the entire set from 0 to z, whose pre with respect to f that you look at, not only with respect to z.
Isn't it the preimage of z infinity and infinity excluded because you want all the functional values that are higher than
that? Yes, that's right. Yeah, it's just... don't like you. That's right. No, so the picture was right, and my ability to translate the picture into the formula seems to be seriously not there today. So fourth and last section for today are the function spaces LP. And they're always over some set with some sigma algebra and some measure. The function spaces LP. It's just the fact that the quantum mechanics of a particle, of a quantum particle in three space dimensions rests on the Hilbert space, D, as we will see, Hilbert space L2 of R3 equipped with the Borel sigma algebra on R3 and the three-dimensional Lebesgue measure. Okay, it's a particle in three dimensions. Okay. This is just the simplest example where it comes up in quantum mechanics, and as it will be probably used by the experimental lecturer quite a bit. Okay, but this is just a fact, and I need to define all these spaces. While we will need the theory that we're going to write down now, for the special case P equals 2 only, as you see, there is a P up here, there's a 2 here, it is worthwhile to develop it for P, develop it for any real P between 0, between 1 and infinity. And P equals 2 is simply special. Okay, so we start with the definition of not quite this Latin LP space, but with the definition of the following set. Well, let me squeeze it down here. Definition. The set curly L, and that's a precursor to this L, curly LP, is a set of functions, namely a set of functions f. We go to this general case where the function is defined on any measure space m sigma mu. So we go from the underlying set m into the complex numbers. Well, why not? We are doing quantum mechanics. And we have the requirement that f is measurable. Measurable, and it's obvious that you equip the C here with the Borel sigma algebra of the topology on it with respect to the absolute value in C. F is measurable, and you might have assumed that it should be integrable. No, it's measurable, and the integrability condition we write down is the following one. The integral over the absolute value of F to the pth power, d mu, this ought to be less than infinity. Okay. So this is, the set is defined like this for any p between 1 and infinity. That's the definition. Equipping LP with pointwise addition. Pointwise addition and S multiplication. You know how that works, right? I explained this before. Pointwise addition, S. Shall I say it again? Last time? Okay. So what you need an addition on this space that does is a map that does this. So you need to take two elements of that space and you need to map them to the result. The result gets the name F plus G. But you need to define this, and you define it pointwise. That means because there are functions, you say that for any m in m, this plus, which is a plus on the LP space, is defined as f of m plus g of m, which is a plus on the target C, where your functions live, because they take values in C. So the plus on the target induces a plus on the space of functions to this target. And similarly, you do it for an S multiplication. So I explained this before. In the future, if I say pointwise, I will refuse to explain it again, right? This is an alpha and an F. And this goes to alpha dot f. This is this one on LP. And alpha dot f on LP, this is the LP S multiplication, is alpha times f of m for all m. So here I should write for all m in the domain, for all m in the domain. And this is the multiplication on C. Okay, so with pointwise plus and S multiplication. And that's why we have this terminology pointwise, so one doesn't need to write this down every single time, makes LP, well, the full name is LP of M sigma mu, but I often write only LP, comma plus, comma times, into a C vector space. Okay, so we have a vector space. Now, I would like to make progress in the direction of Hilbert and Banach spaces. Let's try to make this LP vector space into more. Let's give it a norm. Once it has a norm, it's a normed space, and then one can set out to check whether the space is complete with respect to the norm, which would make it what? A Banach space, right. And it turns out these LP spaces are all Banach spaces with respect to a norm. But there is a slight complication in between, which is often suppressed in the quantum mechanics courses, but which indeed in applications like in solid state physics and so on, you're punished for it, neglecting it. Right? So almost everything I say, almost every mathematical subtlety here, I could give you a physical application where it's really important to do that. Right? But I don't do so because I trust that you trust me. That's all important. Okay, so theorem, but it goes in a few steps now. Theorem, the map, and that map has a funny symbol. It's a wiggly line that takes you from LP to the real numbers defined as wiggly F. It's very difficult not to write xi in this place. Okay, the wiggly F is defined as the integral over the F to the pth power d mu. Aha, we know that's less than infinity for every element in LP, right? Well, that was the assumption. You take this number, will be a non-negative number, and then you take the pth root. Again, p can be any real number between 1 and infinity. Right? You define this thing, you certainly get the following. Is a, and it has a name, a semi-norm, because it lacks one important property of a norm, but it has the following properties. Well, first of all, it's positive homogeneous, so for all, well, it's homogeneous, it's what it is. It's for all alpha in C, well, it's all this terminology used in different ways. If you take alpha F, then this is the absolute value of alpha times F. Okay, that's good, right? That's the property of a norm for all the F in LP. And the second thing that's satisfied, and that's not so easy to see, I think it's called the Minkowski. We should probably write a little p down here because it really depends on this p. So for every LP space, you have another such norm. It's not the same everywhere as you can see here. So maybe a little index p tells you to which space this norm belongs. And then I think it's called the Minkowski identity, but anyway, so for all F and G in LP, we have that F plus G with the P norm is less or equal to F P plus G P. Okay, so you have the triangular inequality. Remark. And you have, third, And you have that the absolute, not the absolute value, the P norm of S is always greater or equal to zero. But what would you need for a norm? Yeah?
The equality holds if and only if F is the zero function.
Yeah, that exactly, exactly, that's right. That this implies this would be required for a norm, and that simply is not true. As you can easily see, if F is zero almost everywhere, the right-hand side will be zero. But what is required is not that from this it follows F is zero almost everywhere. The norm requires that F is zero full stop, not almost everywhere. No? You need to get the neutral element of addition of the vector space. And F equals zero almost everywhere is not the neutral element. Obviously not, because the result, if you add something that's almost everywhere zero, you add it, it's no longer the previous vector in LP, right? So this does not hold, and that's the reason this is only called a semi-norm. Well, it's more like a quarter norm or something, but anyway, so it's not a full norm. And this causes trouble, and this trouble means we're not going to work with the curly LP spaces. So I make the remark down here. Okay, remark. Curly F P equals zero only implies F equals zero almost everywhere, right? And this makes this problem makes LP plus times Wiggly seminorm not even a normed space. So we can forget our ambitions about a Banach space as long as we haven't provided a normed space, right? So how do we get a normed space? That's the old high school tested system of getting rid of the troublemakers, okay? And the troublemakers here are, of course, the functions that are almost, that are zero almost everywhere. So there are two ways to go about this. Let me inquire which one is more congenial to you. Do you know what the quotient of a vector space and a subspace of it is? No. Do you know equivalence relations? You know all, okay, let's do it by equivalence relations. I mean, it's the same thing anyway. At the end of the day, it's the matter of approach. Okay, to remove the troublesome F, which are zero almost everywhere, while refusing to be zero everywhere, define the following equivalence relation. So what is an equivalence relation? Call FG in our curly LP space equivalent, and we write F twiddle G. By definition, if and only if, by definition, F is the same as G almost everywhere. So you can see this equivalence symbol is the equality symbol seen through somebody who refuses to see sets of measure zero. If you're blind to sets of measure zero, this is the equal sign. Now the question is this an equivalence relation? What do you need to check for an equivalence relation? Three properties, I hear. Symmetric, reflexive, and transitive. That's right. Is a function equal to itself almost everywhere? Yes. If f is almost everywhere the same as g, is then g almost everywhere the same as f? If f is almost everywhere the same as g, and g is almost everywhere the same as h, is f almost everywhere the same as h? Well, yes, because the union of two sets of measure zero is a set of measure zero. Why is that? So I said you have a set of measure zero, let's call it A, that is where f is non-zero. You have a set of measure zero where g, A is this set that underlies this almost everywhere, and B is the set that underlies this almost everywhere. So this is the set where this equality is not true, and A is the set where this equality is not true. Okay? And I know that mu of A is 0 and mu of B is 0, right? Why? Because they're sets of measure 0, otherwise I couldn't say almost everywhere. What is the measure of the union? Well, the measure of the union is, if I don't know about the intersection, I know it's less or equal to mu of A plus mu of B. Well, but they're both 0, so this is 0, and the measure is always greater or equal to 0, so the measure is 0 too. This proves the transitivity down here. So really, we got ourselves here a pretty nice equivalence relation. Why are equivalence relations interesting? Why are you excited if you have one? Well, the equivalence relation is always looking at things in a more forgiving way. So I look at all of you, and I see some of you look intelligent and the others not so much. I'm obviously kidding. But I will ignore that in the exam. I'll say I don't care how intelligent they look, I'll just look at the results, right? No, so the point is, you have information about a set, you have elements, but you decide to ignore something. It's always identifying objects that are actually different, but from the point of view of the equivalence relation, you identify them. I choose to ignore. Okay? I choose to ignore. Now, the very interesting thing, if you choose to ignore, is that you have a quotient set. So for any equivalence relation, twiddle on a set M, in our case M is LP, one has the so-called, and that's a terrible name, and it's a perfectly simple concept, the so-called quotient space. And with the terrible name goes a terrible symbol, and that's the quotient space. What is the quotient space? It's so simple. So you have a set M, and in the set M, you have the boys and the girls, okay? And now you choose to ignore the individual characteristics of the boys, a tall boy, a not so tall boy, and the individual characteristics of the girls. And what you say, I call two elements of the set M1 equivalent to M2 by definition if and only if the only thing I look at, so this is the girl with the long hair, this is the girl with the short hair, Okay, you come up with other modifications here, okay? With a tie, okay. Anyway, so you call two equivalent by definition because you choose to do so if and only if the gender of one is the gender of the other, okay? Let's say, and you need a definition of gender, okay? We can discuss this at length. The nice thing is you can choose any definition here, right? Okay, so, but the point is you simply identify. What is the quotient set? Well, the quotient set is then the set of all the so-called equivalence classes of M, where, with respect to the equivalence relation, and an equivalence class in turn is the set of all the M twiddle which happen to be equivalent, well, M bars, which happen to be equivalent to this representative of this equivalence class. Aha, so this girl lies in the same equivalence class as the other girl. Why? Well, because I chose to only distinguish, to group together who has the same gender. And these three guys with their ties and whatever, they constitute another equivalence class. What is the quotient set? The quotient set is if you start forgetting that there are elements in the equivalence class and you say this blob is one element of the quotient space and that blob is the other element in the quotient space, so the quotient space has only two elements. And you can always show that because of the three properties, reflexivity, symmetry, and transitivity, these blobs never intersect, A, and B, every element in the original space belongs to some blob. Isn't that beautiful, right? And this is only because of the properties of the equivalence relation. Aha, that's why we're so excited. Now, what are we doing here? We're identifying all those functions that differ only on a set of measure zero. And if we then look at the quotient space, what do we afford by that? So this is the general situation for equivalence relations, and that's the meaning of the quotient space. Now what we have done, so for our equivalence relation, F equivalent G twiddle, if and only F equals G almost everywhere, we have the quotient space curly LP mod this identification. What is this? This is all the equivalence classes of functions. So these are functions in LP. We understood them. Now we take equivalence classes with respect to this. The F comes from LP. That's the definition I just gave in the abstract. And this space has a new name. This space is called Latin LP. Latin LP is these LP functions, these functions whose absolute value taken to the pth power integrated converges, right, is finite, rather, is finite. If I take these, but I identify all those that differ at most on a set of measure zero, right? And then I only look at the equivalence classes. So in our drawing over here, say here lies the true zero function, okay? Then here may lie a function f that's zero almost everywhere, but it isn't zero. But the LP space can no longer distinguish between the two, it just sees yellow. And then you can check that if you take F plus G and you define thereby the addition on LP, How do you know that the addition on curly LP carries over here? Well, you don't. You have this. You need to define this. You need to say, well, add the two and then take the equivalence class again. And this is the plus in curly LP. But who tells you that this is well defined? Who tells you that if you take another F that represents the same class and another G that represents the same class, that adding them and then taking the equivalence class is the same? Similarly, you have to take alpha F. You take alpha times F equivalence class and define this as the equivalence class of this. So this is then the S multiplication LP. You define it via this S multiplication LP. Again, you need to check that these are well defined so that it doesn't depend on whether I choose this guy to represent F or this guy, or not this guy or this guy to represent G, and so on. And in particular, you can show that the entire equivalence class of the zero function, so that's the zero function in LP, but it becomes the zero class here, right? You have to show that really this one is the neutral element of this LP space. Ah, so the entire class becomes this neutral element, and then you can inherit the norm, inherit a norm on LP simply by taking the equivalence class. So this F is taken from some curly LP, but the elements of Latin LP are these equivalence classes, and you say that the norm of this equivalence class, you define it as the squiggly norm on the representative. Again, you need to check that this is well defined, that it doesn't depend on the representative. Because here you take a representative, but for the you need an equivalence class, but for the definition you use the representative. Well, you better make sure that this guy represents you as well as this guy. So you need to check. All of this needs to be checked. And you certainly did well definition checks sometime in your mathematics education. Did you? You look puzzled, so that makes an extra problem this afternoon in the problem class. Okay? So we can discuss this there. So you do this, and then it turns out, that's the result, it turns out that looking at the equivalence classes under this identification, or rather looking at the elements of the Latin LP space, you get the following theorem. This guy, sub P, I should have called it sub P2, and there's a sub P everywhere because that was our notation, so that this guy sub P defined on the set of equivalence classes or this LP space, this is a norm on, well, on LP. Aha. So that means, immediately it follows, that LP over some measure space equipped with the just defined addition and S multiplication on LP, and this norm, also just defined, is a normed space. And then one has to work a little, but not too much, but I just quote the result theorem. LP, with all the dressing and the norm and so on, is a Banach space. Aha, so it's complete. It's a complete normed space. And the point it is entirely has to do with being the Lebesgue integral in the definition of this curly LP. If that was the Riemann integral, you couldn't show completeness. So again, we need completeness for our theory. So this is where the Lebesgue integral makes its first major appearance. And then as a fact, and that's usually referred to as the Hölder inequality. So if you now take two p's, you take a p and a q, and they both lie between 1 and infinity, and they satisfy the extra condition that 1 over p plus 1 over q is 1, right? I mean, they're real numbers in this range. Then you can take the integral f times g d mu, and of that you take the absolute value, and that will be less or equal than integral of the absolute value inside f to the pth power d mu taken to the 1 over pth power plus integral g absolute value qth power d mu taken to 1 over q. This holds, and this is called the Hölder inequality. So this is true for all pq in this range. And now if you look at this very sharply, you see that on the right-hand side, there is the p norm and the q norm, right? The p norm and the q norm. And on the left-hand side, there is an f times g, and that is put together to a number. And I should make provisions. I'm sorry, I should rephrase this because we're over the complex numbers. I wish to put a bar here. Observation. So this is true. Now the observation is letting, just for fun, fg be defined as integral f times g, f bar times g, d mu. Okay? One can check that this is an inner product. Aha! So I should be careful. I should actually take the inner product on the equivalence classes because I want this to be an inner product on the Latin LP space into the complex numbers. But for its definition, I use representatives. So again, you have to check whether this is well defined, and it is. If you have this, you check that this is a sesquilinear inner product as we defined it. Aha! So under what circumstance does this become a Cauchy inequality? You know that if you have a norm that's induced from an inner product, an immediate conclusion is that the Cauchy inequality is satisfied. And the Cauchy inequality would be this. Well, you know this can only be true. It can only be the same norm on the right-hand side if p equals q. But p equals q requires that both are 2, so that 1 half plus 1 half is 1. So this is only true for the 2 norm. So only for the case p equals 2, only for the case p equals 2, do you get a Cauchy inequality. But because the Cauchy inequality is necessarily there, if you have the norm induced by an inner product, you can conclude that the others don't, other norms for p not equal to 2 do not come from an inner product. And in fact, it's even true, theorem, that L2 over some measure space with the above defined addition and S multiplication on the equivalence classes and the just above defined inner product is a Hilbert space. Well, it's clear that it's Hilbert because as a normed space it was Banach, it was complete. The Hilbert space is complete if it's complete with respect to the induced norm, so this is more a corollary, right? But that is the important bit. And this is the space that people rather nonchalantly call the so-called. I write so-called because you see this construction has many subtleties. The so-called square integrable complex functions. Or as they're often called in physics, the wave functions on this space M. Well, if M is R3, this is the Borel sigma algebra, and this is the Lebesgue measure, you have what people usually mean if they say a wave function. But it's an element of this space, and you see it's subtle because it's the equivalence classes rather than the functions themselves, and so on. And only this L2 is a Hilbert space, and hence underlies quantum mechanical systems. The other spaces are no good for that. They're only Hilbert spaces, the other LP spaces. They're only Hilbert, they're only Banach spaces, but not Hilbert spaces. Okay? So this is the famous L2 space. And again, I emphasize integrable means necessarily Lebesgue integrability, otherwise it doesn't work. It's not the complex functions, but it's the equivalence classes of the complex functions under identification of any two functions that are the same almost everywhere. And this is just in the quotient space. Okay? If you take this into account, you got it. Yes?
Where you wrote down Cauchy integration,
inequality.
Mm-hmm. The equivalence classes? Or do you just implicitly define a new product?
So I need the equivalence classes here as I need them up there. And here, of course, I also have the equivalence classes. Otherwise, it wouldn't exist on that space. I defined this norm before. And where I defined it, I should have written equivalence class of FP is defined as squiggly norm of the representative P. Okay? So then we're good. It is a tradition to not write these equivalence class symbols all over the place. We just write the representatives, but we simply need to keep in mind it's actually only up to equality almost everywhere. So if you want to be precise, you want to have the right object in here, you need to write the equivalence class. Okay. But then, of course, I can say that I call the equivalence class capital F. Okay, but you see, as soon as you then start, so here you could just write capital F, capital G, capital F, capital G, but as soon as you write something like this, you need to know, the equivalence class, but the number is defined in terms of representatives, requiring a well-definition check. Okay? This is how this works. So I'm pretty sure this was probably one of the first things you did in mathematics for physicists or in analysis anyway, that you checked these things and you learned about well-definition of such expressions where you make a pick. You see, in order to write down the right hand, so you define the left hand side, but you need to make a pick of some element of this class and you put it there. And whenever you make a pick rather than being uniquely driven there, you need to check that any other pick you could have made would have produced the same result. Otherwise, your prejudice defines the value. That's not particularly desirable, right? And that is the check of well definition of where it's independence of the pick you make.